हेलो एवरीवन, दिस इज़ मिसेस कुलकर्णी एंड टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट द लास्ट चैप्टर ऑफ हिस्ट्री, 10th स्टैंडर्ड हिस्ट्री, दैट इज हेरिटेज मैनेजमेंट. ओके, सो बिफोर प्रोसीडिंग लेट अस सी व्हाट एग्जैक्टली योर हेरिटेज मीन्स. हेरिटेज इज अ प्रॉपर्टी और द पोसेशन विच इंडिविजुअल हैज पोसेस्ड और एनीथिंग यू आर ब्रिंगिंग लाइक नो लाइक इनहेरिटेड, ना, जो हमारा पूर्वजों से जो हमको मिलते आ रहा है. इट्स इंडिविजुअल पोसेशन और एनी थिंग विच इज़ नो आप शायद आपने अर्न किया हुआ होगा या फिर आपके एंसेस्टर्स ने जो मतलब वंश परंपरा से सालों से जो ईयर बाय ईयर पीढ़ी बाय दर पीढ़ी जो आप उसको मेंटेन आ रहा है वो प्रोसेस करके आ रहा है, दैट इज़ योर हेरिटेज. ओके, एंड इन दिस चैप्टर दस वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी अबाउट हेरिटेज मैनेजमेंट एंड वॉट इज़ दैट हेरिटेज. तो वी जस्ट नाउ वी हैव सीन एनीथिंग विच वी आर पोजेसिंग फ्रॉम जनरेशन टू जनरेशन, दैट इज़ योर हेरिटेज. एंड मैनेजमेंट इज़ यू नो हाउ टू मैनेज इट. ओके, एंड इन दिस हिस्ट्री एट द लास्ट वाई दिस चैप्टर इज इंक्लूडेड इन योर सिलेबस, बिकॉज सी इफ यू सी फ्रॉम द फर्स्ट चैप्टर सो देर यू हैव सीन द हिस्ट्री इन ऑल द फील्ड्स, लाइक इन द फील्ड ऑफ आर्ट, कल्चर, मास मीडिया, एंटरटेनमेंट, स्पोर्ट्स, tourism, and wherever you see the different types of materials we are, you know, inheriting, that you know, generation by generation that we are carrying it out, isn't it? So when we are carrying it out, so it is our duty to maintain it further for our future, for our next generation. So for that management is very important, how to manage it well such that the people who are coming in the next generation, even they can enjoy the whatever we are looking at now. Because if you see now, you have seen the different chapters in history, and you have seen the, like, you know, different fields, like, you know, mass media, you have seen how the history, how the mass media has evolved, you have seen art and culture, how it has been evolved, you have seen tourism, how the tourism is becoming an important part in economical development of the country, because we, whatever the things our ancestors were possessing, we managed it, and because of that the tourism is getting, you know, that privilege, isn't it? So as they maintained for us and we are enjoying it now, so it is our duty to maintain it for our next generation purpose, such that they can, you know, study or they can enjoy that. So if I talk about the recent thing, if I talk about whatever the pandemic we are looking through, now we are going through, that is corona, okay? But even this is, you know, in next coming generation, maybe after 100 or 200 years, maybe the next generation, they are reading this as, knowing this as a history. So for that, whatever the recent things we have, so it should be processed, it should be stored such that there then after 200 years or 100 years the next coming generations may look at as the history or whatever the pandemic we are going through. For that, the recent whatever things are going on and whatever the things we have, those should be recorded and those should be maintained in a proper way, and that will be carried out to them as a heritage, isn't it? So let us start with this. Let's go with the introduction. The sources of history and all the history books that are available today are the results of diligent work of several historians, isn't it? See, whatever if you see, the books are written, the diaries are available, photographs and all. So these all are the things which, you know, our historians, they have saved it. So we can get all these resources, like institute, like libraries, museums and archives, conserve and preserve this precious historical heritage. So these all materials are collected and preserved in the different fields, like you have libraries, we have museums, archives, isn't it? So there everything is, the historical things are collected and the historical heritages are collected and they are kept such that we can see now, we can use it now, and we can get the knowledge about the past. They choose important specimen from the heritage collection and exhibit them. They also publish research journals, informative pamphlets, leaflets, posters, etc. The documents and artifacts which are not exhibited but historically very important are stored in the museum and archives after completing necessary treatment for their conservation and preservation. See, what does it mean? See, many things are kept as it is for the recent research purpose and all, but many things like, you know, the books, the artifacts or the diaries might have may not be in that condition there where exactly we use it as a raw material, like raw, however they are. So what our historians, what they do, they process it, okay, they preserve it, and whatever the required activities are needed to preserve it, so everything will be done, and later those are kept in museums, libraries or archives. Okay, then as whenever necessary, the libraries preserve and manage the books. So in library and archives we have a different collection of books, and as you go see further in this chapter, you will come to know what's the difference between libraries. Okay, then what are the sources of history and their conservation and preservation? So let us see that, because this chapter is all about the heritage management. Heritage management, as already discussed, what is heritage? Anything we are possessing from generation to generation, that is your heritage, and how to manage it for that, different types of conservation and preservation processes. So that we'll see. Okay, according to the sources of history, you have studied in the 9th standard first chapter the sources of history. So you have different categories: oral sources of history, material sources, written sources, isn't it? So when you have different types of sources of history, then definitely the way how you preserve it is different, isn't it? You can't store the oral history as written, and you can't store the written history as material, historical things, materials, you can't store it as written, and written you can't preserve it as, you know, material kind of. So at every as the different categories of sources of history are histories are available, so we have different types of preservation and conservation methods also. For example, audio, visual, whatever you like, now also if you see, if you have anything in audio, you store in the CDs, DVDs and pen drives, isn't it? And written things are like, you know, either we have on the paper or on the diary. Okay, earlier they were not like that, the manuscripts were written. And the material sources you have, like coins, the clothes, the artifacts. So you can't handle the paper as the coin, and you can't handle the coin as your oral history or source, isn't it? So at every source of history, the methods of conservation and preservation are different. Each step, like collecting the source of history, creating their records and indexes, in exhibiting manuscripts, old books and artifacts after completing necessary treatment, requires very careful handling and management. See, we have different types of sources of history you have studied in the 9th class. So there, what exactly you have? So creating their records and indexes, matlab whatever the different types of sources we have, we should keep a record of that, isn't it? And when we have a record, it should be kept index wise, such that if you are going to search it again, so looking at the index, you can see. Then, like, you know, exhibiting the manuscripts, old books, artifacts. So on this, the different, you know, necessary treatments are required to handle it and manage it properly. It needs people with specific skills. Only trained persons who are duly qualified can make up this task. So we have seen, we know we have different types of sources of history, so the different processes are being done on different types, and just to perform those processes, we need only trained person or the qualified person to do that task. Okay, so on this, the question may be asked, like, you know, and I think in the first class of your history itself, I told this is very important chapter, heritage management. On this, you know, the question can be asked, why only trained people are required? Why can't you hire any person? Okay, so think on that. Then let's proceed with the oral source of history. So before proceeding to the oral source of history, so I would like, you know, let us see some basic thing, how exactly the management can be done. Okay, so if you see, I think in one of my classes I have been told you that still the research is going on, that the scientists are trying to catch the frequency, because the frequency of our ancestors, what they were talking, matlab, you know, they are working on a machine where it can catch the frequencies. As we know that theory, energy can neither be created nor be destroyed. It's only can be converted from one form to another form. So when the people are like, when we are talking, then definitely whatever food we are we ate, so that energy is being converted into our speech, right? Whatever we speak, so that energy, it is not destroyed, so it is somewhere in the atmosphere. So the research is going on, still the research is going on to catch those frequency of our ancestors. And just imagine if that our scientists, if they will succeed in this kind of thing, you know, we will be more beneficial. The mankind will be more beneficial. Okay, so let us see how the oral source of history, how they are collected and how they can be managed. Okay, collecting and compiling of folk songs and folk tales, etc. See, right now the research, as just we have discussed now, the research is going on just to capture those frequencies. But right now we don't have that technology, but we can collect and compile the folk songs and folk tales. Folk tales, so the stories, what our ancestors they do, the folk songs. So in that folk songs you have different types, you know, at different, if you go to different areas, so there the songs may be like praising some king, praising some personality, so that there you will come to know that person was ruling there, or that king was ruling there, or there that kind of society was there that time. So these are the oral sources of history, like, you know, the folk songs and folk tales. Then when we get those, then we should classify them, analyze them and interpret the compiled material. Like, how, see, if I heard some the songs, if you recently also, if you see that this is a season of that Nag Panchmi and all, if you see some people, they hold their hand in the chauraha and they play some kind of the folk dance and all with the folk song. So in that folks, if you see, so there may be praising. If you listen that carefully, exactly, so there may be, you know, they may be explaining a particular era, and you can come to know exactly. See, that time maybe I have heard, like recently I have heard the people were singing the folk song on Gandhiji and how he was, you know, like his lifestyle and all, how he's impacted on the society and all. So there you can analyze it. Okay, so that Gandhiji was like, what was his time, so when he was there, so you can classify them according to their time, like time zone. So analyze in that whatever the work they have done, and interpreting the compiled material, then whatever the information we get, so that should be compiled. Okay, then publishing the results of respective research, then whatever the information we compile from those oral sources of history, then it should be published as a result of that research. So if you see also that, what is that Bharud, hena, even and Pavadas, so the Pavadas, so we know that Pavadas are at the time of Shivaji Maharaj. So if any Pavadas, if you can hear, like Tanaji Maharaj Pavada, if you hear Tanaji, that that time, so you can come to know. So the Tanaji was during the time of Shivaji Maharaj. So that time, you know, you can, like, you can classify them, analyze them and interpret them, and whenever you interpret them, you can publish them in a respective research. That, okay, is your oral source of history. Then just to proceed that, okay, what are the just now we have seen, just to maintain all, we need the trained people. So you can't tell anybody to hire anybody and tell them how to manage it and all. For that, necessary training is necessary, the well qualified people are needed. Okay, and I ask the question also, why? Because see, even though I have a desire to fly the aeroplane, whether I can fly there, I can just fly that No, for that the training is needed and a pilot only can do that, isn't it? So if I want to go and drive the car directly, can I go and drive it? Maybe I have the desire, but I need to get the training for that, proper training for that. A trained person only can do, isn't it? So why? Because they know the rules and regulation, the importance, and everything, है ना? So that's why the necessary training is required to do any work. The same wise here also for heritage management, the necessary training is required to maintain the different types of sources of history. Okay, the first one is sociology and anthropology. So these are the two departments where you study the human culture, human society. Okay, human culture, human society, how the human development has been done, how they are functioning in their society and all. Okay, in anthropology you see the human biological and physiological characteristic and the revolution, and in sociology you study the social problem. Okay, if you see the oral source of history, so there you can hear, you might have heard, I don't know, but you might have heard about Razakar. So I heard from my grandmother, so she was singing the song, folk song related Razakar. So that Razakar is that time the social problem. So they were depicting the story of the social problem, what they were facing during that time. Okay, so sociology, anthropology are you know, the different the study and the stu they study the human culture and functionality, and the person who want to handle this oral source of history, so they should know the sociology and anthropology. Then social psychology, मतलब at particular era, so during this time to this time, at this king time, ruling time, and this emperor ruling time, how was this social psychology? Then mythology and linguistics. Mythology, how the people, like the people were, you know, they were having belief on which religion, and linguistic, what kind of languages they used to talk, or what kind of languages they used to, you know, practice for writing and all. Then library science and information technology. Why this library science and information technology is needed? Because whatever the oral information they get, so related written information they can get in the library. And after interpreting that, information technology is needed to store them. Okay, then history and historical research method. Like whenever you go to library and if you see all these links, so you can come to know what was the history and you can exactly get the link. And finally, writing of research reports and articles. Okay, so here you should know oral is no chemical is needed, but only for this, you know, lots of research, lots of linkage you should link, and you know, the lots of work should be done, not that practical process like adding the chemical and you know, cleaning it and all, as we see in material and written sources. But here, having knowledge of different languages, mythology, the social psychology of the people is very important. The next source of history is your written source of history. So, as the name itself implies, the written source of history is obviously any historical thing, okay, that where anything is written, like inscription you have, okay. Collecting coins and copper plates with inscriptions on them, documents like official records, personal correspondence and diaries, historical books, old books, manuscripts, pictures, photographs, etc. So these all are categorized under the written source of history. Okay, so now if you see, we have lots of manuscripts are written, the inscriptions are written on the stone, on copper. Okay, that we have different type of pictures, photographs and books and all. So anything is written on any material, so that comes, that categorized is under that has categorized under written source of history. And here, how to manage this? This process is different. Here you like, you know, definitely whenever you look at the script, so we'll come to know about language, where language information is needed. But if you see the old manuscripts or any official records or diaries, so if we are carrying them for the thousands of years, then definitely that material might have been, you know, damaged. And if you see nowadays, it is very hard to maintain the books of 10 years old, but how they might have done it, for years, thousands of years, if we have many diaries and books, so the letters might have fainted. If we have the photograph and pictures, the colors might have fainted, isn't it? If we have stones and all, so there the many portions might have cut. Okay, so here the handling these sources is totally different. You have for the oral source of history. Then here, compiling necessary mechanical and chemical process of cleaning for the conservation and preservation of collected document. So how, see, as I said, you know, see, if you keep, for example, if you take the recent example only, if you keep anything for the 10 years at the single place, so the dust, you know, the spider nest, everything will be, you know, accumulated on that. So if you go and clean it, definitely some of the part will be damaged. So you can't handle those historical things in that rough way. So that some mechanical and chemical processes should be done. As I told, if we have the pictures or the photographs where some of the pictures colors might have fainted, so you can't go and just wash with water and all, isn't it? It just, you can't do that. So for that, many chemical and mechanical processes are required to do on that, such that their originality should not be disturbed, and whatever the information we want to get, it should be collected from that exactly. Okay, for that many chemical and mechanical processes should be done. Okay, then ascertaining the historical value of collected documents. So it should not harm whatever the process we are doing, it should not harm. Okay, and then exhibiting selected documents, then whatever documents we have got, it should be categorized in that, you know, particularly at what era we have the systematic, you know, selection and exhibiting the selected documents, then publishing edited documents and research report and whatever the after processing and all, whatever the information we get, so after editing it should be published research report. Then for this, what are the necessary trainings are required? The knowledge of scripts like Brahmi, Modi, Persian, and their development. Because if you see the different types of the inscriptions we have, so there nowadays what we have like English, French, Marathi, Hindi, so there were not the languages earlier. So there we were having Brahmi, Modi, which we are not aware of now. So if you want to really work on them, the written material source, history sources, and if you want to really get the information, then the knowledge of these scripts is must. Then basic knowledge of social organization and traditionals, literature, culture, dynasties, administrative system, etc. of past society. So if you really want to, even though you may be knowing the different languages, and you might have done, you can read those written scripts, but you should know the dynasties or the administrative system, the literature, culture, matlab during whose period, which type of linguistic inscriptions were written. So even that basic knowledge of that should be must. Okay, during Ashoka, like, you know this, on Ashoka is having many inscription, copper inscriptions and stone inscriptions, but they should know during his rule with what languages they used to talk or they used to practice and all, isn't it? So that link should be there. The basic knowledge of that social organization also is important. The knowledge of various schools and styles of painting and sculptural art and history of their development. And if you see some pictures or paintings or photographs, so you should know which are the different universities or the schools or the styles where these types of painting they used to teach. Okay, see, these painting, like, somewhere they might have learned it, and that learning might have done, they might have completed from some particular schools and colleges, you know. So you should have the knowledge of that also, the various schools and styles of painting, what they used to do in the history. Then knowledge of types of papers, ink and colors. Then nowadays we have the papers and all, but earlier they were not having the concept of paper, and they used to write on the leaf or they used to write on the skin of the animals. So you should know, like, but by looking at that or by touching at that, you should tell, like, you know, the written material on what they have written. Okay, the types of paper, the knowledge they should have, the kind of ink they have used, colors they have used. So they definitely they may not be using, might not have used whatever the recent ink, chemical ink we have. So they may have used the natural colors or ink, and you should know, like, you know, the basic knowledge of all that one should have to process the written material. The knowledge of properties of various stones and metals used in used for inscriptions. Then the types of stones or metals they have used, you should know. Why? Because so by this will come to know what kind of, you know, age, stone age, copper age, you know that, isn't it? So that knowledge should be there. Then the types of stones, because everywhere the same type of stones are not available. Okay, so that basic knowledge you should have. Knowledge of equipments and chemicals used in various processes of cleaning, preservation and conservation. See, all the knowledge of stones should be, you should know, and you can't process the same chemical procedure on all type of material. Then you should know on which type of material or on what kind of stone, what kind of which chemical should be used. So that knowledge you should have. The knowledge of various approaches of managing exhibitions in museums, galleries and information technology. Then how you manage the exhibitions in the museum, and how you store, how you get the information, that how you represent through information technology, that you should know. Then then writing the research reports and articles. Finally, after getting everything, once you get the information, and after linking everything and performing the required process and all, finally the research report should be ready. Then the next type of source of history is your material source of history. So in this material source of history, in the image you can see collecting artifacts, classifying them according to their historical date and type, and preparing indexes. So here you can also see the clothes they might have seen, the ornaments they might have used, the crockeries and all. Here you have the coins, the artifacts, the different equipments they have used. But even in the material source of history, their ornaments and clothes also can come. Okay, so that is. And completing necessary mechanical and chemical process of cleaning for the conservation and preservation of collected documents. Like whatever the things we have got in the material source of history, definitely the cleaning, the cleaning process should be done. And for that, we have discussed, you have specific mechanical and chemical process. Okay, so you have coins. So some iron coins might have got rust, some gold coins might have damaged. You have copper coins, silver coins, and you can't handle iron as gold, gold as silver, and silver as copper, isn't it? Every materials are having different chemical properties, so that the chemical use should be different. You know what I mean? Then you have clothes. So you can't, like earlier in the materials sources, as I already told, you have clothes also. So recently, like nowadays, how we wash with the surf and Nirma, like go and just wash in the washing machine? No, you can't do like that. If you have historical materials of cloth and all, then the mechanical and chemical process of cleaning those is totally different. Then arranging exhibitions of selected artifacts or their replicas. Then arrangement, see, and here the some artifacts you can't keep as it is in the exhibition. Their replica should be it should be prepared. Replica is duplicate copy, because you know who will feel good to see the broken mug to drink water or tea. So the old one also is kept, and same look like as the replica of that models are kept, such that it should look pleasant. And for that, see, for example, if I tell, see, like, you know, if you have a statue, okay, if you have a statue or like very old statue or any toy which we got in the history as a historical resource, and if you assume one hand and leg is broken, Okay, and if that that toy is kept in the museum, is it okay if you see and enjoy it? No, no. So they will do the processing and all, but they will make a replica of that toy such that you can enjoy and you can see, you can, you know, imagine how this toy may be looking like this, like that. Okay, then writing and publishing research articles about collecting artifacts. Okay, then classifying fossils of plants, animals, and preparing indexes. So you know the fossils of, like, you know about fossils. Okay, so classifying them accordingly and making the index, then exhibiting selected fossils for their or their replicas. Then definitely if we have the fossils, then their replicas will be done. Like the best example, if I say about your dinosaur, and so earlier the dinosaur, they might have got only the skeleton or only one part, but later for that way, you know. And here also the question comes, if the trained person is there, no, then they can think about that, they can have exactly link that if aadha portion hai to ye pura hota to kaisa hota, ye agar dinosaur ka skeleton hai to iska flesh kaisa hoga, iska structure kaisa hoga. So for that training and imagination is needed, and later the right have done. For that basic training, the necessary training is that basic knowledge of archaeological method and theory, history of ancient civilization. Okay, so uske liye you should have lots of knowledge about the history and civilization and all. Then knowledge of the regional sources of materials like stones, minerals, metals and clay used in the production of artifacts and their chemical properties. Okay, if you see some China, you know that we see the different artifacts, the plate they used to eat. So if you see some materials are not available in India, so definitely by looking at that you can say either they might have brought from here, isn't it? So like that knowledge of everything should be needed. Then knowledge of equipment and chemical necessary for the cleaning of artifacts and other chemical process. So this is everywhere in all the type handling all type of material. Knowledge of various schools and styles of art and their development, as already we discussed in the last also material, that see some things, some different types, some types of arts are, you know, practiced in particular school only. So that having information about that is also very important. The knowledge and skill of making replicas of artifacts and fossils. Yeah, this is very important, because by looking at anybody's skeleton you can't prepare anything, you know. So for that the knowledge should be there. If it is the skeleton, then how it should look like. Okay, so that knowledge is very important. Knowledge of various approaches of managing exhibitions in museum galleries and information technology. Then finally the same, writing the research reports. Okay, so we have seen the different types of sources of material, sources of history, and how to manage and just to manage them in a proper way, what are the necessary trainings are required, and as we already discussed, very skilled and trained persons are required to manage the historical the sources whatever we have got. Okay, and we have seen they do and all the different types of sources of history are processed in different way, and they will be exhibited in either museum or they can be represented either under as a written material, isn't it? Then, and when we say they are exhibited in the museum, so let us see some famous museums in the world. Museums were earlier, like, you know, let us have a basic what exactly museum is. Museums were created to recognize and manage the antiquities collected by members of royal family and elite families of medieval Europe. So what exactly museum is, like, you know, museum is like can't handle it. Earlier it was not done everywhere, so it is used to exhibit the antiquities and the, you know, antique pieces whatever the royal families were collected, just to show them. So one place was, you know, organized, so that is called as museum. Then the famous museums in the world are the Larvae Museum, France. Okay, the Larvae Museum, France, in Paris, was established in the 18th century CE. The antiquities collected by the members of the royal family were exhibited in the Larvae Museum. So it includes the much acclaimed painting of Mona Lisa by Leonardo da Vinci, the world's renowned artist. So if you see here in the slide, the picture of Mona Lisa and the artist who drawn that picture. Okay, in the first picture you have Mona Lisa, and the second is the artist, the Leonardo da Vinci. Okay, so the Hans Sloane, he was a scientist. So he used to collect the pictures of different plants, herbarium. Then later the collection was expanded by the addition of various arts objects, ancient artifacts collected by the British people from the British colonies. So he was like Hans Sloane was a main contributor who has given the different types of information, the specimen pictures of our different types of plants, and later the different artifacts were presented by the British people of the different British colonies. Then presently the museum comprises of about 80 lakhs of objects. So in the picture you can see the British Museum. And the third one is National Museum of Natural History, United States of America. So this is the most biggest. The BIS Museum of Natural History, managed by the Smithsonian Institute, was established in 1846 CE. It houses more than 12 crore, about 120 million specimens of fossils and remains of plants and animals, minerals, rocks, human fossils and artifacts. So if you see, compared to from France to England and England to America, if you see, the size of museum is getting bigger and bigger, and the number of artifacts which are kept in the museums is more. So here in this you have more than 12 crores of artifacts. So there you have the fossils, remains of plants, animals, minerals, rocks, humans, and okay, etc. And just now we have seen the different museums all over the world, and let us see some few famous museums in India. Okay, the first museum in India, the Indian Museum, was established by Asiatic Society of Bengal in Kolkata in 1814 CE. Okay, the first, and this kind of question may be asked, find the mismatch. The first Indian Museum was established by Asiatic Society of Bengal, that is in Kolkata. The second museum in India is the Government Museum, was established in Chennai. And in 1851 CE, the National Museum was established in Delhi in 1949. So the first picture is Calcutta, second is the Museum of Chennai, and third picture is of the Museum of National Museum of Delhi. Then, presently there are several museums in various states of India. Usually the big museums have their own archives and libraries. Some museums are affiliated to the universities. Such museums also offer course of museology, where you study how to manage the museum. Okay, the following are some of the well-known institutes and universities which offer degree and diploma courses in the museology. Okay, we like these are the famous one for the first, second, third, as all everybody will remember the first or second one. Nobody will remember the the further people. As now also, if you see someone, if you hear someone, then they'll ask, they know only who was the first person who landed on moon. They don't know who is the second person, So they were the three the first three museums in India, but now in every well-known metro cities you have the museum and archives. Okay, then next we are going to see the different universities which are going to provide the degree of museology. What is museology? It's a department, it is a degree, where you can get, you will get the information to manage. Then the universities in India, the offers degree and diploma in museology are the National Museum, the National Museum, Delhi, Maharaja Sayaji Rao University, Vadodara, Calcutta University, Banaras Hindu University, Varanasi, Aligarh Muslim University, Aligarh, then Jivaji University, Gwalior. So if you see the pictures, so these are different universities in India which are providing the degree and diploma. And let's come to Maharashtra. So here, the Chhatrapati Shivaji Maharaj Vastu Sangrahalaya. In 1904 CE, some influential residents of Mumbai decided to establish a museum to commemorate the visit of Prince Wales to इंडिया. सो लेकिन नो इन 1904 मीन्स बिफोर इंडिपेंडेंस द रिच एंड फेमस रेसिडेंशियल्स ऑफ मुंबई दे डिसाइडेड दैट वेन एवर द प्रिंस वेल्स ही विज टू इंडिया सो सो देयर विल बिल्ड अ म्यूजियम. ओके देन इन द मंथ ऑफ नवंबर 1905 सी द फाउंडेशन वॉज लेड ऑफ द म्यूजियम बिल्डिंग. इट वॉज डिसाइडेड दैट द नेम ऑफ द म्यूजियम वुड बी प्रिंस ऑफ वेल्स म्यूजियम ऑफ वेस्टर्न इंडिया. ओके टू कमेमोरेट हिज विजिट टू इंडिया सो दे वर डिसाइडेड कि विल ओपन अ म्यूजियम एंड विल कीप देयर. ओके इट वॉज रीनेम्ड एज छत्रपति शिवाजी महाराज वस्तु संग्रहालय इन 1998 सीई. द बिल्डिंग ऑफ द म्यूजियम इज बिल्ट इन इंडो गॉथिक स्टाइल. ओके बिफोर इंडिपेंडेंस एज इफ द फाउंडेशन वॉज लेड सो द बिल्डिंग इज इन द स्टाइल ऑफ इंडो गैथिक. एंड लेटर द प्रिंस वेल अर्लियर द म्यूजियम नेम वॉज प्रिंस वेल्स म्यूजियम ऑफ देन लेटर इट हैज रीनेम्ड एज छत्रपति शिवाजी महाराज वस्तु संग्रहालय. एज पहले द सी एस टी है ना दैट वॉज अर्लियर नेम्ड एज विक्टोरिया टर्मिनल एंड लेटर इट हैज बीन कन्वर्टेड रीनेम्ड एज छत्रपति शिवाजी टर्मिनल. ओके सो लाइक दैट डन. द बिल्डिंग वॉज इन द इंडो गैथिक स्टाइल. इट हैज बीन गिवन द स्टेटस ऑफ ग्रेड वन हेरिटेज बिल्डिंग इन मुंबई. ओके सो इफ यू सी इन मुंबई यू हैव डिफरेंट ग्रेड्स ऑफ बिल्डिंग्स. यू हैव इन द सेम सी एस टी एंड दिस ऑल आर ग्रेड वन हेरिटेज बिल्डिंग्स. द म्यूजियम हाउसेस अबाउट 50,000 एंटिक्विटीज आर डिवाइडेड इंटू थ्री कैटेगरीज आर्ट्स आर्कियोलॉजी एंड सो दिस इज ऑल अबाउट द म्यूजियम द डिफरेंट टाइप्स सोर्स ऑफ हिस्ट्री. वॉट इज हेरिटेज मैनेजमेंट. वाई द ट्रेनिंग इज नीडेड. वाई द ट्रेन पीपल आर नीडेड. वाई टू यू नो रिस्टोर द हिस्ट्री. वाई टू मैनेज इट. वाई टू प्रिजर्व इट. एंड वी हैव सीन द डिफरेंट सोर्सेज ऑफ हिस्ट्री. हाउ टू मैनेज देम. हाउ टू मेंटेन देम. देखो द डिफरेंट प्रोसेस ऑफ वी हैव सीन. एंड वी हैव सीन द डिफरेंट म्यूजियम्स ऑल ओवर द वर्ल्ड एंड द फेमस म्यूजियम्स इन इंडिया. एंड लेटर वी हैव सीन द म्यूजियम द छत्रपति शिवाजी वस्तु संग्रहालय ऑफ महाराष्ट्र. एंड इन द नेक्स्ट सेशन वी आर गोइंग टू सी अबाउट द लाइब्रेरीज एंड आर्चिव्स एंड एनसाइक्लोपीडिया. सो दैट विल कंटिन्यू इन द नेक्स्ट सेशन. ओके थैंक यू.